Jesus. We love him because he first loved us, don't we? Oh, how I love Jesus. Let's all sing. If we love him, we'll follow him in our footsteps. Let's turn to page 325 and sing Footsteps of Jesus. This song is special to my heart. Teresa and I had this song played at our wedding. And sung Footsteps of Jesus. How that we want to sweetly, Lord, we've heard thee calling us and saying, come follow me. And let's follow Jesus this morning and what he'd have us to be. Roberta, come and lead us. Service here at Valley Hill Baptist Church in beautiful Hendersonville, North Carolina. This is Palm Sunday, April 5th in the year 2020. And wow, what a past few weeks have been. And let's pray for all the other churches that are doing a lot of their services online due to necessity. And we need to pray for our community, our county. I think I've heard the reports this past week that here in North Carolina that they were expecting every county to have a case of the coronavirus before all this is over. And we've not reached our peak yet, they tell us, and so we have much to be in prayer for. But it's wonderful to be able to meet together today. Like I said, this is Palm Sunday. We're 1 week away from opening up the veil of the temple there, and I use that as an illustration. And I'm so excited the next time that you see me standing behind this sacred desk, this pulpit, the curtains behind me will be opened, and you'll see the cross up there in its full glory. And I'm so excited about that. I'm so excited about Easter Sunday. And you know, that's one thing that has not been canceled this year. A lot of things have been canceled, a lot of sports has been canceled. A lot of sporting events, a lot of races, things of that nature. Some of the sporting seasons have been delayed or postponed. And I know the school children, a lot of schooling has been canceled for the rest of the year. And we would have never thought about this last year. And I know that it has canceled a lot of things, a lot of proms. And the graduations, of course, will have to be dealt with in a different manner this year. I understand all that. And I'm sorry for all those that are affected. But this has been a worldwide event. But one thing that is a worldwide event that will not be canceled, and that, of course, is Easter Sunday morning. Now, every Sunday, let me explain, every Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. That's why we as a Christian church celebrate each and every Sunday as a time to remember that this is the Lord's Day. This is the day that Jesus came out of that tomb and He rose from the dead on that third and glorious day after dying on the cross. And of course, this is Passion Week, and we'll be referring to the cross a few times a day. Every good sermon needs to take a trip back to Calvary, and we need to get that cleansing. We'll be talking about that in just a moment, and we need to get that understanding of what Jesus did for us on that blessed cross. And I thank God for the cross, and we don't worship the cross, but we worship Him, the one that died on the cross. We worship the one that didn't stay on the cross. He rose again on that third and glorious day, and we're celebrating that. We'll be celebrating that all week long, and we'll be thinking about those things. And like I said, today is Palm Sunday. The title of today's message is Jesus, the King and the Lord of Hosts. Now, if you've been following some of our sermons, and now that we're online on our YouTube channel, you can go back and watch as many times, or go back if you've happened to miss one. You can go back, just click on the date of service that you would like to see. And they're all archived there. And that's one good thing that has came out of this, that we have an archival way of preserving some of our sermons and maybe reaching people that otherwise would not have seen them. But Palm Sunday 2020, Jesus, the King and the Lord of Hosts, oh, worship the King, all glorious above. And as I was saying, if you've been following our messages, we have been studying and preaching out of the book of Joshua. And last Sunday, we were in the book of Joshua and how that the God's people had built up momentum after spending 40 years just wandering in the desert, wandering in the wilderness. They were finally building that momentum to start moving forward and to get to the promised land and to live that victorious Christian life that God desires for each and every one of us as we grow into that sanctification process that God desires for us to be and to live in a victorious Christian life and the Christian living. You know, for the past several weeks, we've taken a look at the movement of God's people from the wilderness wanderings to the promised land. Crossing the River Jordan, God desires His people to live that victorious Christian life that we were just talking about. There was momentum building up. They were finally on the move after all of that wandering and that just going from place to place, basically just going in circles there. But there was momentum in the people through God's working. And then, of course, the miracle of the parting of the River Jordan. But then God did something that no one was expecting. And sometimes God does things in our lives that we weren't expecting. Just like with this coronavirus, this COVID-19, this has been something that has brought a lot of things to a halt and to a stop. And that's exactly what God did with His people. As you remember in the last message last week, God brought everything to a halt. There must be a time of spiritual cleansing, a spiritual circumcision, so to speak, to remove parts of our life that do not belong. So we're going to concentrate on that today. We're going to think about the things that come into our lives that do not belong. So we're going to see that in God's precious Word today. God's Word is sharper than any two-edged sword, and it will cut, and it can cut deep at times, and there will be bleeding, and there will be hurting from that. But with the proper cleansing and care, God brings a healing. God brings healing, and then after the healing process, then comes worship. Now, we've spent a lot of time talking about worship and obedience in the past year, and as I've brought sermon after sermon about true worship, and that is truly our purpose, our creative purpose is to worship the one true living King. Oh, worship the King, all glorious above. Now, if you would turn in your Bibles, if you can, to Joshua chapter 5, verses 13 through 15. We're going to look at three short verses today, and we're going to be looking at the end part of chapter 5 where we left off last week. And so if you have your Bibles, turn to there. Let's begin reading together. And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, Art thou for us or for our adversaries? And he said, Nay, but as captain of the host of the Lord am I now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship, and said unto him, What saith my Lord unto his servant? And the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, Loose thy shoe from off thy foot, for the place whereon thou standest is holy. And Joshua did so. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask His blessings upon the reading of His precious word. Heavenly Father, I thank You so much, Lord, for allowing me just to stand here behind this sacred desk, Lord. I thank You for that privilege. It's more than an honor, Lord. And Lord, I pray that as we read Your word and study Your word together, Lord, I pray that You would just open my mouth to say the right words, the words that You would have Your people to hear, Lord. And I pray that everyone that is listening today and watching this, Lord, I pray that that they might just have their hearts and minds open to what Your precious word would have for us to hear today. Lord, help us apply it to our lives, Lord. Teach us what You have us to know, in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Now, you may be watching this, or you may actually be eventually be listening to this on the radio. And wherever you may be, wherever you're able to turn in your Bibles or not, God has a message for each and every one of us to do today and to apply to our hearts. There's little doubt in my mind who was Joshua is referring to here, who Joshua has seen. In order for there to be true worship, there has to be a true King. And that I'm speaking none other than the Lord Jesus Christ. The captain of the host of the Lord is the Lord Jesus Christ Himself, the same one who wrestled with Jacob, the same Lord Jesus who stood side by side with the three Hebrew children in the fire, and the same Lord Jesus Christ that stands with you and I when we become in desperate need at times. He said He would never leave or forsake us, and He never has. He's never turned one away, and He never will, and He will never forsake any of His children. Revelations 1:8 says, I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty. He is the Almighty, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Joshua speaking with none other than the Lord of hosts was the Lord Jesus Christ. Revelations 19:15 says, And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword. John's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ in this, in the Revelation. And I'll speak up this reading again, Revelations 19:15, And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. Now, we find a parallel. We find more than one parallel in the lives of Moses and Joshua here. The parting of the waters, the parting of the Red Sea, with Moses leading God's children through the parting of that water. And then you see the parting, the parallel of the parting of the Jordan River, and Joshua leading God's children through this water as well. Now we find another parallel of Joshua talking with the Lord Himself, part of the Trinity, and the Lord Himself telling him to remove thy shoe, loose thy shoe from off thy foot, for the place whereon there standeth is holy. It's holy ground. The things that we pick up on our flesh from our feet. Now, let's remember something here. We're not of this world, but we live in this world, and we walk from place to place. Let's remember that. And that's why God himself, and I'm going to read this in Exodus chapter 3, verses 4 and 5, that God himself asked Moses the same thing. Let me read this for you. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. We're talking about none other than the presence of the Lord God Almighty. The things that, as I spoke of, the things that we bring in off our feet from this world that we track in ought not to be. The things of the flesh that we pick up ought not to be. Needs to be removed. I'm drawn to the attention of the feet here. I'm drawn to the attention of the places that we walk. Now we all know the little song that we sang as we were little children. We still need to be teaching to our youth, be careful little feet where they go, be careful little feet where you go. For the Father up above is looking down in love, so be careful little feet where you go. And I understand the meaning of that song. It goes on to be careful little eyes what you see, be careful little ears what you hear. For the Father up above is looking down in love. So be careful, little eyes, little ears, little hands, what you do, little feet, where you go. But we also need to remember, as throughout our sanctification, our life, that we're walking through a filthy, dirty world. I'm drawn to attention again, like I said, to the feet. We're in this world. We walk in this world, but we are not of this world. We're citizens of a heavenly city. We walk in a filthy world full of corruption. But as we enter into this special time of year, each and every Sunday, as I mentioned before, is Resurrection Sunday. Praise God. That is why we meet and worship together on Sunday. And hopefully one day we'll be able to come back together as a church family and meet together. And be able to take Holy Communion one with another and to see each other for fulfilling the Great Commission together and to fulfilling that. But we worship on the day that our Savior rose from the grave. We serve a risen Savior. Praise God, He's alive. You ask me how I know He lives? Because He lives inside my heart. Hallelujah to that. I want us to think back in this week of history, the last week that Jesus was here on earth during his earthly ministry 2,000 years ago. I want us to think back to the original Palm Sunday, and I want us to go back there through God's Word, and I want us to think about the things that happened during this week. We know a lot about this week in our Bibles. There's a lot recorded in the Gospels for us, and we're going to be looking at several parts. But I want to begin by saying this, that ahead of him was all his suffering and his passion, his triumph over death, hell, and the grave. But let's look at the things that were behind him. Behind him were his sermons. Ahead of him, his sorrow, his suffering. Behind him were the parables that he taught, the Sermon on the Mount, the parables that we still preach about upon this day. But ahead of him was his passion. Behind him was the temptation. Oh, the 40 days that the devil tempted Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, in the wilderness. But ahead of him was his triumph over death, hell, and the grave. Behind him were the delights of Galilee. Ahead of him was dark Gethsemane. Behind him was prophecy all the way back throughout the Old Testament, prophesying of a Messiah that was to come. But ahead of him was the practicality of the cross, the realness of the old rugged cross. Behind him were the suppers and meals of the disciples, a fellowship. But ahead of him was the Last Supper and of betrayal. I want us to look in John's Gospel. We're going to be looking at John and Luke's Gospel in just a moment. But I want us to think back in John chapter 13 as we place ourselves inside this week, this Passion Week, so many years ago, that Jesus had gathered the disciples one last time for the Last Supper. And that Jesus had after he had finished, after he had blessed the bread, he had broke the bread. And starting in verse 4 in John chapter 13, he said, He riseth from the supper and laid aside his garments, and he took a towel and he girded himself. And after that he poureth water into a basin, and began to wash the disciples' feet, and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. Could you imagine having your feet washed by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? Then cometh he to Simon Peter. That's what was Peter was thinking. And Peter saith unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? Are you going to wash my feet? And Jesus answered and said unto him, what I do thou knowest not now, but thou shalt know hereafter. Peter saith unto him, thou shalt never wash my feet. But Jesus answered to him, if I wash thee not, Peter, if I wash thee not, thou hast no part of me. Hands and my head. Wash me from head to toe. Jesus saith unto him, he that is washed needeth not save, but wash his feet, but is clean every whit. Clean, but not all. For he knew who would betray. You're not all clean. There's an example of humility shown here. And Jesus gives us an example as well. As we're going to continue on in verse 14. If I then, your Lord and Master, have washed your feet, ye also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that ye should do as I have done to you. But there's also an indication here. I want us to pay very close attention here. There's an indication of the cleansing of the feet. As we walk and we travel through this world, we pick up things that don't belong. Peter had made this awesome remark to the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, you'll never... And Jesus said unto him, Peter, I can't have anything to do with you if I don't remove what doesn't belong. And Peter said, well, then wash me from head to toe, Lord Jesus. You have to love Peter for some of the things that he said. Peter was trying to be humble here, and he never was going to allow the Lord Jesus Christ to stoop and to wash his feet. But when he saw that he couldn't have anything to do with Jesus Christ because of the things of this world, he said, wash me from head to toe. Now, I want us to learn something here. I know that this has a wonderful example of humility, and even an example of us as under-shepherds to be a servant under those that we serve. I understand that. But I also want us to understand that Jesus was telling Peter, said, Peter, you're saved, you're clean. But it's those things that we get, that we walk, the parts of the world that we collect, that needs to be removed, that we have to go back to the cross. I'm so glad that my Bible still has 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now pay close attention. That's not sin, S-I-N. That is sins. If we say we have no sin, we're just fooling ourselves. We're lying to ourselves. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But Peter, we as like Peter, we're saved. But we must make that trip back to the cross. We must look back to that cross for that cleansing. Sometimes as our lives get 90 miles an hour, what was happening? We build that momentum. Jesus brings all that to a halt and says, we have to do something here. There's a time for a cleansing. There's time for healing. And then there's time for worship. And I want us to look back also as we go back and our thoughts and our minds are going racing back to that first Palm Sunday. As Jesus was entering into Jerusalem, the crowds were placing palm leaves into his path, protecting him. And so to speak, this was holy ground. This was holy ground where the Lord of Lords and King of Kings would be walking. They were singing Hosanna in the highest. Let's take a look at Matthew's gospel. I'm going to look at Matthew chapter 21, verses 8 through 16. And I want us to start building this picture of what was taking place as Jesus was triumphantly entering into Jerusalem, headed to the cross, 1 week from the cross. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way, coming between the earth and the world and the Lord Jesus Christ. So appropriately, and the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he was coming to Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? Who's coming? And the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. And Jesus went into the temple of God, cast out all of them that sold and bought in the temple, and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves, and said unto them, It is written, My house shall be called the house of prayer, but ye have made it a den of thieves. And the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. And when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were sore displeased. And said unto him, Hearest thou what these say? And Jesus said unto them, Yea, have you never read, Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, thou hast perfected praise? Perfected praise and worship? Have you not heard this? Well, I'm here to tell you, not everyone is pleased with true praise and worship. There are some that would rather not have it be. But I love what Jesus told them as creator of everything, that if those people didn't praise him, guess what would? The rocks would. The trees would. The birds singing. They still praise his glory in the mornings, especially this time of year of springtime, when you hear the birds out there chirping and singing praise to their creator. You see the wind blowing the trees of the leaves of the trees moving around. Give it glory to God, the creation. I believe that. In Luke 19, let's look at these verses, Luke 19, 37 through 40. And when he was come nigh, even now, at the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees from among the multitude said unto them, Master, rebuke thy disciples. And here's the verse I was just referring to in verse 40. And he answered and said unto them, I tell you that if these should hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out. Praise God for that. That the stones would cry out. Let me tell you something. One day, every knee shall bow. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord of Lords and King of Kings. Let us worship him today. Let us not have the Creator have to call upon the rocks, the trees, to cry out to him and worship him. Let us worship the King today. Let us worship him fully. Let us give him all the praise and the honor and the glory for it all. For he is worthy. Worthy is the Lamb. Let us not worry about offending others. Let us not worry about giving him the honor and the praise and the glory that he truly deserves because it might offend someone or because it's not politically correct. Let us give God the glory and the praise. Amen to that. Romans 14, 11 says, For it is written, As I live, saith the Lord, that every knee shall bow to me, and that every tongue shall confess to God that he is Lord of Lords. One day, every knee will bow, either on this side of eternity or on the other side of eternity. Please make it this side of eternity. If you've never asked the Lord Jesus Christ to come in your heart, if you've never truly worshiped the King, ask the Lord Jesus Christ to come in your heart today. Have that removed from our lives. Have the sin taken away from us. Be cleansed from what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross and be gloriously saved. There comes that healing. Then there comes that true worship. Call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. Admit. It's simple as ABC. Admit. Admit that you're a sinner and need to be saved, for the wages of sin is death, but that the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans 10:9 says that if thou shalt confess with our mouth that the Lord Jesus, and thou shalt believe in thy heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Thou shalt be saved. Admit that you're a sinner. Call upon the name of the Lord. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. That yes, he died on that old rugged cross. Yes, he shed his precious blood for us so that we could live. So that he gave his life-giving blood so that we could live and have life and have it more abundantly. But he didn't stay there, just as Romans 10:9 says. We have to believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead that third and glorious day. As we look to Easter Sunday, 1 week from today, let us worship the true King. Let us worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I love what Paul and Silas said to the Philippian jailer in Acts chapter 16. The night about midnight, they were chained and shackled in that old dark Philippian jail. And Paul looked over to Silas and said, "Let's sing a hymn." And they began singing, and a great earthquake came. They started worshiping. They started worshiping the true King. The Philippian jailer heard the earthquake. He came in, and all the chains, the doors were open, the chains were off. And he thought that everyone had ran away, and he was about to take his own life. When Paul says, "Do thyself no harm. We're all here. We're all here." And the Philippian jailer says, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved? I want to worship as you, but I'm not saved. I don't know this Jesus, this God that you're speaking of. What must I do?" Not the jailers, not my friends. "What must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house." And they spake unto him the word of the Lord, just as we've been speaking the word of the Lord today. You know, God's word tells us that we need a Savior. Our God's word tells us that Jesus came and died on that cruel, rugged cross. God's word tells us that he rose again on that third and glorious day so that we may live. He lived so that we may live. Call upon the Lord Jesus Christ today. If you've never asked the Lord Jesus Christ to be your Savior, today is the day of salvation. Now is the accepted time. Just call upon the name of the Lord. If you've never asked the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, let's all pray this prayer together. Lord Jesus, Lord, I admit that I'm a sinner. I admit that I've done things that I shouldn't do. Lord, I believe in my heart that you came and died on that old rugged cross, that you shed that precious blood to save me from my sins, Lord. Lord, I believe that God rose you from the dead and that you're alive today, sitting at the right hand of the Father. Lord, I confess these things with my mouth and that I believe. Lord, thank you for coming into my heart. Lord, be my Savior. Lord, I thank you for saving me, for calling me, and for loving me. If you said that prayer today, I can give upon the full authority of God's word itself that you're now a member of the family of God. If you've asked the Lord Jesus Christ, please let us know here at the church. We'd love to pray for you. We would love to get to know you, send you any materials that you may need to help you along your Christian journey. But most of all, welcome to the family of God. God bless each and every one of you. Until next time that we meet again, amen.
I sing, oh, my hope is in Jesus. I thank God my yesterday's gone. And all my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. Come on and sing, oh, my hope is in Jesus. Yes, it is. I thank God my yesterday's gone. And all my sins are forgiven. Oh, I've been washed by the blood. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.